Hari Om, everyone. And I just wanted to say I'm a dancer. I'm primarily a performer. And my knowledge or limited knowledge of Advaita as I know it has come from sitting in Swami Chinmayananda's and Swami Dayananda's lectures. And I think it's largely more Swami Dayananda because I was too small when I was sitting in Swami Chinmayananda's lectures to assimilate more than I could when I was 6 or 7, I think. So there are two parallels that I want to draw. One is based on the content that we deal with in Bharatanatyam specifically, and I think it applies to all classical Indian dance forms. The second is in the act of performance itself, how this idea of Advaita permeates through that. So the first thing is we have listened to a lot of things about folk as well as Vedantic ideas of how Advaita permeates through different cultures in India. And I feel that in the performing arts, all these ideas are there. In all the traditions of understanding the self are imparted in these many layers. So I just want to say how I understood it, and then I will parallel it to how it works in dance. So when I was a child, I think it's the same for all of us. You sit on your grandmother's lap and they'll tell you stories of Krishna and Rama and some things from the Mahabharata, but I think mostly Krishna. For me, it was mostly Krishna. And then when you're scared in the dark, your mother will say, you know, don't worry, Krishna will be there. You say Krishna, Krishna, and he'll protect you. Then I learned that Rama Skandam Hanumantam Vainatiyam Prakodaram. So whenever I used to walk in the dark, I used to say Rama Skandam Hanumantam. I hope no monsters come and catch me. So this is a very, this is an introduction, I think the first introduction to the ideas present in Sanatana Dharma, which is a very, like we kept saying Saguna Nirguna, and I think this was the form that as children we just understand the form. And so from that it progressed on to the next level of understanding. I think when you're young and youthful, just like Meera was told that Krishna is your husband, I used to have this poster of Krishna and Radha on my wall, and I kept wishing I was Radha. So it's a very automatic transition that happens as you grow older. And in our dance poems, this idea of love making and this bridal mysticism exists to a very large extent. And even in life, this is how it is. Even with Meera, the stories we hear of Meera, Radha, Andal, they're all the same things. That of this this Lord or this idea of this Paramatma taking on the role of your spouse. And it has, and I realized much later that it's not gender bias. It's not a man and a woman. Like I heard this story of Meera once where I recently did a production of Meera. So I had to read about 25 books based on her because of Swamiji actually. So he said, you do on Meera, and I had to read all about her. And there was one story where she goes into Vrindavan and she wants to meet this saint, and he says, I don't see women. And she says, in his eyes, all of us are women. Meaning that, and then I realized, actually in Bharatanatyam and in classical Indian dance, especially in my generation, in the younger generation, everyone raises this question. Why is it that this woman is always pining? Why is it that this forlorn woman wants a man? And there is this man that is there, and the woman always wants him. And this is very gender bias. The woman is less. This is not right. And I felt like saying that's because you don't understand Advaita. Because it's not woman and man. It is us as limited human beings longing to know the self. And that is why it's just a woman and man. There's a very simple song. And we do also in Bharat Gupta said earlier, in the Natyashastra, the layering is there. Just as we understand from when we are a child, for every level of spirituality that we have something that accesses us, something that caters to our being. From a child to a philosopher, everything exists. Like whether it's a song and a poem or a folk song or a story or the idea of Krishna being your friend or Krishna being your lover or you finally understanding as Krishna being the Paramatma within everyone, the level of understanding exists in layers. And in our performing arts, it not only exists in content, but in presentation also it exists in layers. Like for example, when we do, I think most of the topics have been covered today, like from Devi to Ardhanarishvara. These are all the things that we use to Tyagaraja's Kritis. This is all the content that we have in classical Indian dance. And it definitely shifted more to bhakti after the bhakti saints. But even the other content that is there, like largely inspired, I think, from Jayadeva's Ashtapadis, which we use a lot, where there's a lot of bridal mysticism. And there is this idea of love making. And I think when I was younger, I didn't understand how this was right, you know, because the lovemaking of Krishna and Radha is described in such detail that you almost think it's pornographic, you know. But the thing is that Jayadeva writes and says, in the end, he says that if this is how they will understand Krishna, so be it. Meaning that I understood much later the parallel that exists, that the lovemaking is that moment, those moments of self-realization that we have. And the want of Radha to possess Krishna is what we feel in life. And in reality, she cannot possess him because he belongs to everybody. In the Rasa Leela, he belongs to every single gopi. So every single gopi has a Krishna. But Radha thinks that he is hers. So she wants him. But only when she surrenders to him, does she realize that he is actually hers. You know, so in terms of content, I think I need not go in because we have actually covered all the content. But there's another thing that I found. I'm actually speeding through it because we've had a long day. So in the terms of performance itself, there is something that happens when you are a performer, like when you're a dancer. There are two aspects to performance. One is, as an artist, I think you need to learn the technique. You need to learn the singing, the steps, the aesthetic. Your hand needs to go exactly where it is. You can't be thinking about, is my natyarambam right? Is my hand correctly? Is my hand too high? Is it low? The mastery of technique, during the mastery of technique, your ego exists in its fullest because you have that sense of accomplishment. Yes, I have that note. I held my aramandi for 25 minutes. I can hold my dance now. My form is clear. And your ego exists completely. We also have a mirror, dancers. You know, we have a mirror and we look and we check constantly, is our form clear? Then we have this understanding of other parts of technique, of how we imbue character, how we fill our minds with imagination. So if I'm becoming or taking on the character of Radha, how do I cultivate imagination such that I feel the character of Radha completely? How do I go into that? How do I step into that? How do I see Krishna in that imaginative space? This is also a skill. It's not something, because you need to be Radha and the next moment you need to be Krishna. In this part of training also your ego exists. But there is a point during performance when you no longer think about your technique. You no longer think about the music. You no longer think about the rhythm. Because the rhythm and all of this becomes second nature to you. And then you cease to exist. And only the dance exists. And there are these moments, I think, as artists that we experience them. And you experience them more and more. And I think this is the only time that I feel completely devoid of my ego. Where I don't feel I am present, I am unaware of the audience, I am unaware of me, I am unaware of everything, because that awareness is present as an umbrella and I no longer need to be thinking, I am showing something to you. I cease to exist and the dance exists more than anything else. Like you said, that was very interesting, you said you had two levels of Brahman. So, I think this is maybe the first level in whatever practice that we have. The next idea of Brahman. So I said, what I feel is that this limited experience of the self or dissolution of ego that we have as performers either can make us very egotistical outside, or if we extend it to life itself, that feeling can extend to humanity at large, and we can then realize that our ego need not exist in life. Theoretically, it's very easy to say. Practically, it's a much more difficult thing to do. Otherwise, we would all be Swamis. But this is the idea that I feel that happens in performance. The second thing that I feel philosophically that exists, especially when you are a character in theatre, is that Swamiji would always say that we are all like, you know, it's like actors, it's like actors. And I don't think it makes sense to me for a very long time. And I think after he passed on, I realized, you know, I understood what he was trying to say, in the sense that I think when I understood my dancing technique, I actually understood what he was trying to say. The thing is that as a performer, we take on many characters. Like I become Ravana, I become Krishna, I become Radha. I become many different things. Let's say I, as who this body, can be the Brahman, and we take on different characters, just like we take on different people. That was one parallel. The second thing is that there is also, when we take on whatever characters we play on stage, it's not that, suppose I am playing Rama and I have a co-actor who is playing Ravana. I don't actually go and kill him, right? So there is a witness that is aware. So this awareness is that Sat or that truth. So this awareness that exists during my performance possibly can be parallel to the awareness that needs to exist while we take on this character that we play. So that awareness of that being that I have during performance, like I can be Rama, I can do justice to this role of Rama and play him well, and I am playing him well, just like I'm playing Rukmini well. So just like I play myself well, I have to play Rama well, but then I need to have this idea of this witness saying, take the light, take the music, walk to the rhythm, kill Ravana on the third muktayam of the second swara. So this will still happen and I will take on Rama well. But the witness that is there will tell me the swara, the kanaki, the count, the calculation. And I felt this was the same thing that Swamiji was trying to say about life. And this is another parallel I felt in terms of performance. The third one that I said, that I felt, is that when you take on a character, like say now I become Ravana. Ravana is a bad character, he's evil. Or let's say I'm playing a killer, like say some theater thing, I'm playing a serial killer and I have to kill 5 people. Now, me, I can judge the killer, right? I can look at the killer and say what the actions he is doing are not right. They are not good. They are not actions that must be emulated. But in reality, when I take on the character of the killer, as an actor, I'm not allowed to judge that character. I must not judge Ravana. If I am judging Ravana, I can never play Ravana properly. I will never be a convincing Ravana. I will never be a convincing serial killer. So, and in reality, we can never be a good Rama also, because that is also not possible by any of us. So the thing is, when we judge the character, we can't play. And we can't also take on the character properly. Yeah, how is that? So as humans, I feel that this was also another thing I was trying to say, is that when we are people and you want to understand that self in us and in others, you cannot judge them. That they are parts, they are playing parts, and we have to understand, and that's another way that we can realize the self is present in all of us. So I will end with that, and I'm dancing this evening, so I think dancing is better than speaking for me. So namaste and Hari Om, and thank you all.